हेलो हेलो हेलो। ओके विल स्टार्ट। पहले विल वी वेट फॉर अनदर 5 मिनट्स?
हाँ, 3-4 मिनट्स लेट अस
विल यू
वेट सर।
स्टार्ट?
हाँ सर, लेट अस
ओके
वेट
ओके
फॉर थ्री
ओके
फोर
ओके
मिनट ओके सर, ओके सर, नमस्ते।
ओके ओके
ଏଇଟା ଲଗେଜ୍ ପୁରା କମିଯାଉଛି, ଶିଖିବା ରହିବ ନାହିଁ। କେମିତି ରଖିବା ଠିଆ କରିବା ପାଇଁ?
सर नमस्कार सर, लेट अस स्टार्ट नाउ सर। कॉल अस सर, लेट अस स्टार्ट नाउ सर। हेलो सर, लेट अस स्टार्ट नाउ सर।
ओके 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 वेरी गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल द पार्टिसिपेंट्स कनेक्टेड थ्रू दिस वर्चुअल एकेडमिक प्रोग्राम। ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ फिलोसफी फैमिली आई एक्सटेंड वेरी हार्टी वेलकम टू ऑल द स्टूडेंट्स, टीचर्स, स्कॉलर्स एंड इंटेलेक्चुअल्स हु आर व्यूइंग दिस प्रोग्राम। फ्रेंड्स, दिस इज द 5th डे ऑफ द वेबिनार सीरीज ऑन द हिस्ट्री ऑफ वेस्टर्न फिलोसफी। On the first day of the series, we had a knowledge of the transition of a philosophical reflection from the history of ancient Greek philosophy to the modern development of philosophy. Then afterwards, we listened the philosophy of Francis Bacon and René Descartes. We did have a foundation of Descartes' meditation also, which was presented by Dr. Anurshan Chuna Samantaray yesterday. Today, we have to listen from the eminent speaker of the today, Dr. Ratnakar Gajendra, on the philosophy of Spinoza. And in the second session, we have to listen from Dr. K. Om Narayan Rao. Dr. Ratnakar Gajendra is a very experienced philosophy teacher in Odisha. Today he will concentrate on Spinoza's view on substance, attribute, and mode. Spinoza is one of the greatest rationalist philosopher of the West. I should not say anything on the philosophy of Spinoza because it will be spoken by our eminent speakers of today, Dr. Gajendra and Dr. Rao. I would like to give a brief introduction of Dr. Ratnakar Gajendra. Dr. Ratnakar Gajendra is an experienced teacher who has experience of more than 35 years of teaching experience in different government colleges of Odisha. From his understanding of Western philosophy, he will give a very foundation and clarification on the basic concept of Spinoza's philosophy today. But when we have to think of his academic career, we can say that Dr. Ratnakar Gajendra is a retired principal of Odisha Education Service. He was also the principal of Calicut Autonomous College in the year 2014. He joined the principal of Government Women's College of Sundargarh on the regular basis after his selection by Odisha Public Service Commission. When Dr. Gajendra was the principal of Calicut Autonomous College, he had tried to open postgraduate in philosophy, and he tried a lot to open PG in philosophy in Calicut College. Due to his initiation, postgraduate in philosophy opened in Calicut Autonomous College, but after his retirement. For Dr. Gajendra, lectureship was his livelihood, but philosophy was his life. Till now, he has a keen interest in philosophy. He attends philosophical conference throughout the country to live with philosophy. From the beginning of philosophy family, he attends every webinar, every day, conducted by philosophy family. We bow down before his keen interest in philosophical wisdom. He feels proud and honored when his student, Dr. Suryakanta Maharana, assistant professor of Allahabad Central University, is being honored for his brilliant philosophical knowledge and speech. Dr. Gajendra, started his career in DAV College, Koraput, and he has served in many other government colleges. During his PG, he was the gold medalist in his batch in the year 1978. He feels proud, thinking that he was the student of Dr. Satyavadi Mishra, Professor Ramesh Chandra Patnaik, Professor Lingaraj Mishra, Professor Sakuntala Mahanti, who taught him the basics of philosophy in UG and PG level. He feels proud being a student of Professor R. Sundarajan in his MPhil class. He got his PhD under the guidance of Professor Dr. Tandra Patnaik. Dr. Gajendra had moved to different parts of the country to attend national and international conferences of philosophy and contributed many articles which have been published in different journals. We are grateful to Dr. Gajendra to be part of philosophy family and to accept our request to be a speaker in the first session. May I now request and welcome Professor Ratnakar Gajendra to deliver his speech on the scheduled topic. Pranam sir, welcome sir. Sir, pranam and welcome sir. Over to Dr. Atnagar Gautam.
At the outset, I express my heartfelt thanks to organizers of this webinar for giving me the opportunity to deliver a talk on the doctrine of substance, attributes, and modes by Spinoza. Is it audible?
Yes, sir,
no,
it is audible.
Audible, sir.
Yeah.
Audible.
Yeah. Attributes by Spinoza. I particularly extend my thanks to Professor Pramod Kumar Das for organizing the webinar in philosophy. He is the real architect behind this function. I express my regards to my revered teachers who made me what I am. Some of my teachers left this world for their heavenly abode. Let their soul rest in peace. I extend my thanks to the senior. I express my regards to my senior brothers and sisters. I extend my thanks to the fellow participants for their participation, without which the webinar would not be successful. I once again congratulate the student friends who are the future philosophers of the state. The subject will be enriched by the deliberations and interactive sessions. Thank you all. Spinoza is a rationalist philosopher, and what are his contributions to philosophy will be known by the, like, if we concentrate some of the statements made in the life history. Benedict D. Spinoza, Baruch Spinoza, or the other his name as Baruch Spinoza, was born on 24th November 1632 in Amsterdam. His genius led him to a different doctrine about God, and therefore excommunicated from the Jewish synagogue about 1656. Spinoza was living by the pittance delivered from the grinding of scientific glasses in 1673. He was offered a chair of philosophy at Heidelberg. Spinoza declined the offer in early January in 1671. At the age of 1677, at the age of 44, he breathed his last. He is the symbol of what is best in the East and West. He was in favor of the monotheism in the West. It reminds us the Vedanta philosophy of East, particularly India. Spinoza has a number of books to his credit. The philosopher is very much famous for his book Ethica. His other works are The Principles of Philosophy of Descartes, 1670, Tractatus Theologico Politica, 1670, Tractatus De Intellects Emendation, Epistole, and recently published book Treatise Concerning God and Man, A System of Pantheism and Atheism, Idealism and Empiricism, Nominalism and Realism, and Naturalism and Acosmism are attributed to him. He was a versatile genius. He was termed as a hideous atheist. He is also called as a God intoxicated mystic. The diverse accounts are due to the criticism and not due to the understanding of his system. If you really understand his system, you may not have all these remarks. Spinoza was considered as Descartes made consistent. This is the criticism of Leibniz, because he is of the opinion that he cultivated certain seeds of Descartes. Descartes was the father of modern philosophy. Descartes ended his philosophy in pluralistic skepticism. Spinoza's philosophy is a protest against it. The philosophy of Descartes may be summarized in these statements. First, the discrete ideas, in order to be true, must be clear and distinct. Second, the essence of God consists in his power of creating and conserving the order of things. And third, the voluntaristic metaphysics which supervails over the intellect. These fundamentals can lead to skepticism. The ultimate guarantee of any truth is the natural light of clear intuition. If intuition is taken as the source of ideas, it will provide the disconnected ideas. There can be no true interconnection in them. There can be no real and rational system of knowledge. Descartes looked upon God for supplying necessary connection for the conservation of thoughts. So Descartes was his contemporary. Spinoza didn't exactly follow whatever is there in the philosophy of Descartes. Descartes, no doubt Descartes influences his philosophy, but he never follows, Spinoza never follows Descartes. The philosophy of Spinoza is a protest against three fundamentals of Descartes. He developed a system which interlocks the ideas of a true rational system. Intellect is the sole means in the philosophy of Spinoza. He begins with the unity of all existent things. Whenever we concentrate the philosophy of Descartes, we will find the philosophy of Spinoza. We find that Spinoza is, according to Spinoza, all our objects of knowledge fall into any three categories, that is substance, attributes, and modes. Philosophers are typical persons. They are trying to generalize the things. They are asking questions like just, what is a cause? They are not asking about a particular cause. Rather, they are asking, but what is a cause? Whether this cause is the real cause or unreal cause, that will be discussed in the philosophy itself. To Spinoza, substance is the being which is dependent on nothing, and on which, this is unquote, on which everything depends, which itself, uncaused itself, affects all else, which presupposes nothing, but itself constitutes the presupposition of all that is. It is a pure being, primal being, the cause of itself and of all. This is the quotation from Richard Falkenberg. Spinoza emphasizes the unity of all things. Spinoza is very much concerned with the unity of all things. He starts with something from which everything can follow necessarily. That something is called as the substance. He accepts the definition of Descartes. Descartes defines substance as which is in itself and conceived through itself. The conception of which doesn't require the conception of another thing in order to its formulation. Descartes had called mind and body as dependent substance, but according to Spinoza, dependent substance is a contradiction in terms. There should not be any dependent substance. The substance is bound to be independent. Descartes had called mind and body as dependent substance. Spinoza pointed out that dependent substance is a contradiction in terms. A substance doesn't depend on anything else. There can be only one substance. If there are more than one substance, it would limit each other. The one substance is nothing but God. God is infinite, and substance consists of infinite attributes. By infinite, Spinoza understands that which is uniquely individual, or the substance can be conceived only in itself. Ordinarily, we understand a thing by comparing it with others. When we say that orange is yellow, we mean that orange has a quality of yellow color which is found in other things. A substance can be understood by referring to itself. The uniqueness of the substance prevents it from having any qualification. Spinoza insists is the maxim, every determination is negation. If you say the substance is moral, he cannot be immoral. Hence, substance is positive and do not have any limitations. As soon as we describe or determine a substance, we limit it. Any description of what substance is indirectly tells us what it is not. Spinoza defines substance as infinite. If it were finite, it would mean that it is limited by something. Substance is the key concept in the philosophy of Descartes. Substance is self-determined and self-contained. He called it Padasvi. Cause indicates an invariable relation between two successive events. Spinoza is not using this term in temporal sense. He finds it in non-temporal sense. As per Spinoza, it explains phenomena and doesn't describe it. It is indescribable, anirvachanya. It establishes the logical relationship between them. By saying that the substance is the cause of the universe, because it follows necessarily from the substance, everything follows from the substance in the way in which all the angles of a triangle are equal to two right angles. So Spinoza used the geometric method to reach at certainty. So he has accepted 27 definitions and 20 axioms and 8 propositions, 8 postulates. So his method was purely geometric method, and the sum of angles is equal to two right angles follows from the definition of two right angles. By defining substance as a Bajaswi, he wants to say that reality is self-explanatory. So whenever we say that the two right angles, the angles, the three angles of the sum of angles or the three angles of a triangle is equal to two right angles, it follows from the definition of triangle. By describing substance as a Bajaswi, he wants to say that reality is self-explanatory, all-inclusive whole. Time has no place in conceiving the reality. Therefore, substance is eternal. Eternity follows from the definition of eternal. Substance is non-temporal and durationless. Eternal means which endures through all times. This is the sense of God of religion is eternal. Eternity, eternal may mean as non-temporal. This is seen in the logical relationship of implication. The relationship of premise and conclusion is not temporal priority. The premise and conclusion are found together because one cannot be without the other. Substance, according to Spinoza, is one or simple. If there were more than one substance, they would limit to another. So Spinoza is devising his concept of substance to be very autonomous and self-creating souls. If we argue that there are a number of substances, the difficulty would arise with regard to that unity and harmony. Spinoza starts with the unity of the universe, unity and harmony of the universe. So Spinoza adheres to the definition of a substance and its influences, held that there could be only one substance. According to Thomas Aquinas, a medieval philosopher, God is natural assurance. He is the cause of all things that exist naturally. The material world is natural naturata. The concept of natural assurance and natural naturata is accepted by Spinoza in a different form. By natural assurance, he means that which is in itself and conceived through itself. This is applicable to the definition of substance. By nature, he means that which are in God and which without God cannot exist or be conceived. That is natura, naturata. Spinoza defines God in such a manner that it did not avoid materiality of the world, but to show that God is not immaterial, but material also. According to Spinoza, the matter is God and God is matter. Substance is absolutely independent of everything. As it is, everything, the totality of existing things, Spinoza calls God or nature. God or nature is the world, is the conception of as pantheism. It is the conception of pantheism. Spinoza is nothing. Spinoza is holding this view and has been referred to as God intoxicated. So Spinoza is criticized, or sometimes it is said that Spinoza is God intoxicated. Pantheism is the relationship of God and the world. What is pantheism? Pantheism is derived from two syllables. Pan means all, theos means God. State that world is God and God is the world. The substance cannot be known without attributes. So this is a brief exposition of substance. Then I shall proceed to the other concept, that is attributes. The substance cannot be known without attributes. Spinoza perceived them as constituting the essence of the substance. they may be either essential or accidental. So attributes may be essential or may be accidental. The essential attributes define a substance without which a substance would cease to be a substance. The accidental attributes are variable in variable characteristics which a substance can lose without affecting what it is. The reality consists of an infinite number of attributes. It establishes a unity which is unbroken. Spinoza is very much concerned with the unity of the universe. How the indeterminate possess properties? Are the attributes ascribed to substance by the intellect? Spinoza has accepted necessary form of thought as having objective validity. The infinite substance is having infinite number of attributes. God is conceived as possessing of infinite attributes in an infinite degree. Of the infinite attributes, the mind can know only two, thought and extension. These two are knowable by man. Each of the two attributes is infinite in its own kind. God has infinite number of attributes. Mind and body are independent of one another. Body cannot produce changes in the mind. Spinoza says that the two things have common, nothing in common. So here I should remind you that Descartes was talking of mind and body, and they are considered as dependent substances. They are quite dependent on the absolute substance God, and which Spinoza, as per the definition of the substance, he says that it is not applicable to dependent substances. Dependent substances are contradictory in terms. Here it is found that his view is similar with the doctrine of occasionalism. Neither mind can produce motion, nor motion can produce mind. The mental cannot be explained by the physical, though they are the manifestations of the sense substance. Mind cannot produce changes in the mind. The mental cannot produce. The physical cannot explain the physical, though they are the manifestations of the same substance. Both of them are necessarily from the substance. Both of them follow necessarily from the substance. They're not by an observation. This is the psychophysical parallelism. Thought has the dual function. They exist in its account and know the other attributes. Spinoza assigns the double status to the attributes of thought and tries to reconcile an inner contradiction with the conception of God. Spinoza's logic doesn't reconcile the contradictory ideas of abandoning the infinite number of infinite attributes. It is seen that Spinoza is caught by his own net, which is spread to find out solutions. He tries to escape the Cartesian dualism, but his doctrine of infinitely many attributes repeats that dualism. Spinoza's absolute separation of the attributes of thought and extension makes knowledge impossible. The metaphysical conflict ends in blind belief or in faith. God is absolutely infinite, but the attributes are not, though they are infinite in nature. Spinoza says that God has infinite number of attributes, only thought and extensions are known by the human intellect. The human intellect cannot have full knowledge of God. These are the limitations of human intellect. According to pantheism, God is the world and all the world is God. The human intellect should have the knowledge of all the attributes of God. Why only two? Why not all? It is observed that all attributes are not perceived by the human intellect. The true cause of a conflict between pantheism and theism in Spinoza's philosophy lies in the three words: God, nature, and substance. Nature, God, substance, the two former found in his earlier writings. The last in the Ethics. So Ethics was a famous book written by Spinoza. And under nature, we are to think of the continuous source of birth. Under God, the universal cause of created things, under substance of the permanent reality. Spinoza holds pantheistic position when he identifies God with the universe. Spinoza's God or substance is the fullness of all the being, all beings. The conflicting tendencies of synergistic philosophy will be more clear when we see the relationship of substance to the finite mode. There has been said that Spinoza wants to reconcile every religion, but he fails to make sure of his own religion. The world is finite and God is infinite. Then how do things proceed from God? If individual things come from God, where does their fitness come from? The infinite is eternal and perfect being. The notion of finite implies that it is limited. In order to answer this question, Spinoza has introduced the conception of modes. Now I have come to the third concept. By modes, Spinoza means, within quote, the affections or modifications of substance, or that which is in another thing through which also it is conceived. Mode is always a modification of something. It cannot be conceived without being. The definition of modes shows that substance or God consists of a multiplicity of modes. The modes are self-dependent and are conceived through God. Modes are both infinite and finite. Modes which are infinite are eternal. Modes which are finite are temporal. The two constitute the face of the universe. Species are eternal and the particular individuals pass away. Intellect and will always exist. Particular human beings will die. The face of the universe remains the same. Parts undergo change, but Spinoza, being a pantheist, bridges the gap between natural naturans and natural naturata. The world of finite things by the conception of infinite modes. Infinite modes follow from the attributes. The immediate and mediate infinite modes are assembled under infinite modes. Spinoza is of the opinion that finite follows from the infinite and infinite from the infinite. Modes being finite implies that God cannot be the cause of them. Which is finite could not be produced by any attribute of the God, because attribute of God is infinite. To reconcile these conflicting tendencies, Spinoza introduces the conception of infinite modes. It is through this infinite and finite are connected. As modes belongs to sphere of finite, infinite modes are related to the infinite. Ideas of the infinite things and the infinite substance come under one head, infinite modes. Though Spinoza says that the finite comes from the finite, the infinite from the infinite, yet he combines the idea of infinite to infinite and of finite to fill up the gap. So Spinoza is not in a position to bridge the gap between finite and infinite. Though Spinoza tried to overcome this conflict, he is not successful in his endeavor. When he sees this difficulty, the finite cannot come out of the absolute infinite, he introduces the concept of infinite modes. At one time, he considers that the finite world is a modification of God. At another time, he is of the opinion that finite individuals are unreal. Synergistic philosophy says that the infinite modes are subordinate to God. The conception of infinite modes appear to be contradictory. It is related to God through his attributes and remains in the sphere of infinity. On the other hand, it is related to finite individuals as modifications of God. The conflict between Spinoza's conception of infinite substance and finite individuals are insoluble. So philosophical problems are resoluble, or there are some problems which remains as it is. Spinoza's philosophy is an attempt to solve it by the conception of infinite modes. The theist conceives the particulars as imperfect. The reality of God as divine is accepted by Spinoza as a theist. The finite individuals are also imperishable because they are manifestations of God. If we look into the philosophy of Descartes, we see that there is a transition from self, the transition of self to the God and then to the world. Here, We have discussed the unit of things, that is substance, then infinite attributes. The substance will be known or will be meaningful by the attributes, and then he comes to the finite world, that is the modes, which are considered to be the affections of the substance. The reality of God as divine is accepted by Spinoza as a theist. The finite individuals are also imperishable because they are manifestations of God. Spinoza maintains his pantheistic stand. The philosophy of Spinoza gives birth through many philosophical theories. He is a theist at one place and a pantheist at the other. So his general tendency is towards pantheism, and sometimes he accepts the theistic position. The infinite modes doesn't assign any meaning to the world of finite in the sense that summation of zeros cannot give any positive number, or the addition of one cannot yield a line. His infinite modes should not be falsely called infinite. His indefinite modes of the indefinite modes should not be falsely called infinite. The metaphysical truth can only be known through the ethical or moral life. Spinoza was very much serious about the moral life of the individual. He, though from the standpoint of logic, he arrives at this conclusion, still his interest is ethics, not logic. Spinoza approaches philosophy from the standpoint of conduct. So the role of conduct is very much highlighted by the Spinozistic philosophy. He is very much serious about the moral life. So eternal bliss flows from the pursuit of one thing which exists by itself and which is in itself. This is the ideal of human life. So Spinoza is no doubt interested in the ideal of human life. What are the models for this human life, or ideals of human life? Let us see. This attitude shows that Spinoza's philosophy was ethical. Intellectual love of God was necessary remedy unless we know him, and his nature is intellectually, we are not freed from the evils of life. So this is the same thing is also found in Buddhism. When metaphysical questions are asked, Buddha himself, in early Buddhistic period, when metaphysical questions are asked to Buddha himself, Buddha tried to avoid the such metaphysical questions. He was not in favor of metaphysical speculations. Metaphysical speculations don't have any merit in the philosophical arena. So he says that metaphysics doesn't be so much helpful. So ethical, his basic aim is ethical, that he tries to find out the cause of suffering, the Four Noble Truths, you all know. So this is the position of Descartes also, Spinoza also. The Spinozistic conception, the theistic conception of God is found evident in the philosophy of Spinoza. He was a firm believer in pantheism, but intellectually he could not adhere to it ultimately. The ethics for him is the science of realizing the supreme good of human life. The supreme good is the love of God. This love of God arises from the knowledge of God. If all is God, as pantheism holds, there should not have any difference between adequate knowledge and lesser knowledge. In Spinozistic philosophy, there are three stages of knowledge, namely imagination, intuition, and scientific reasoning, and intuition. So whenever we study Bacon's philosophy, he is also highlighting in his inductive method that history is dependent on memory, poetry, on imagination, and also philosophy on understanding, or on the philosophy is based on reasoning. So also Spinoza is highlighting there are three stages of knowledge, that they are imagination, scientific reasoning, and intuition. The first stage of knowledge is false or inadequate because it doesn't give empirical truth. The second kind of knowledge gives empirical truth. Scientific reasoning gives you, imagination doesn't give you empirical truth, therefore it is rejected. The second kind of knowledge gives us empirical truth. The absolute is known through intuition. So therefore, all finite individuals are not equal to God. Descartes was highlighting the role of intuition, so also Spinoza is highlighting the role of intuition. So Spinoza's position leads to theism, then pantheism. There are some critics who say that Spinoza is an empiricist. Some critics go to the extent of saying that Spinoza is a materialist or an atheist. Therefore, it is rightly said, somehow it is said that Spinoza was a hideous atheist. Spinoza, as per his logic, comes to the conclusion that God is natural. God is looked upon as a whole in which finite individuals are parts. So Spinoza is highlighting all through his writings that God is the whole and the finite individuals are parts. So there are many inconsistencies in Spinoza's philosophy from the logical point of view. But from the ethical point of view, Spinoza must not be blamed for that. So ethics was the topmost concern for the philosopher Spinoza. What is the main goal of man's life? So whenever I want to sum up this philosophy of Spinoza, I want to know what is the main goal of Spinoza's philosophy. So sum up, Spinoza argues that the way to blessedness or salvation for each person involves an expression of the mind towards intuitive understanding of God, of the whole nature, its laws. So in Indian philosophy is also liberation mind, liberation oriented. All the systems are very much interested in the liberation. So that is one of the characteristics of Indian philosophical systems. Philosophy is a way of life. Philosophy helps us how to live. We must know how to live with farsight, foresight, and deep insight. So also the same thing is found in the case of the philosophy of Spinoza. So in other words, philosophy for Spinoza is a spiritual practice. It is a goal for happiness and liberation. So Spinoza is very much interested for happiness at the end and liberation. So pessimism is initial in Indian philosophy, that is, optimism, we are very much interested for optimism. And in this optimism lulls us into the false security, but pessimism warns us, that is Buddhist teachings. Pessimism warns us of a danger. We said that philosophy is very much interested for spiritual happiness, not the ordinary happiness. And philosophy is very much interested for liberation. So what is liberation? Whenever we are talking of liberation, we are bound to talk of bondage. What is bondage? Bondage from your passions, bondage from your emotions. Whenever we free from the bondage of passions and bondage of your emotions, we are marching towards a stage which is known as liberation. Liberation of the individual. Liberation not of any metaphysical entities. The liberation of the individual is very much highlighted by Spinoza himself. And the goal is happiness. So in Upanishad, that is also highlighted, that sarve bhavantu sukhino, sarve santu niramaya, sarve bhadrani pasyantu, maa kaschid dukhbhag bhavi. So whenever I am reminded of a lecture delivered in Aloysia Philosophy Conferences, my teacher, Revered teacher, Professor R.C. Patnaik, was delivering a talk on the Bhagavad Gita. He says that the Westerners, they read Gita, but as Indians, we live the life of Gita. So this is the fundamental difference between the Westerners and Indians. Though they are having the same work, but the purpose is different. We used to live the life of Gita. So Upanishad, this is also Bhagavad Gita is definitely Upanishadic, and therefore the teachings of Upanishads are found in the case of Gita. So another thing I may be reminded of, that whenever I attended a speech delivered by Professor Hudanand Rai, he was talking on metaphysics and ethics. The metaphysics are the models which are used in practical life. Metaphysical models, whenever applied to practical life, is nothing but ethics. So this is the fundamental difference between metaphysics and ethics. Although we are highlighting the metaphysical truths, still the primary aim is ethics. That means to seek for happiness, to seek for blessedness. So in these few words, I conclude my speech. Thank you.
Hello.
Yes, hello. Sir. Yes, sir. Yes,
sir. Okay. I have
concluded. Okay, nice presentation, sir. Today, you have reflected the basic concept of Spinoza's philosophy, and you have discussed how God is the only substance, and the universe is deduced from one substance, that is God. As you deduce as mathematical truth. Okay. Anyway. Actually, your presentation has made the logical analysis of different concepts. Now, your presentation is open for discussion and question answer. May I now request Devasis? Hello.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
May I request Devasis to moderate the question answer session? Hello, Devasis.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay, over to Devasis.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you very much, sir. And thank you very much to Dr. Ratnakara Gajendra, sir, for delivering a nice presentation on the philosophy of Spinoza. Thank you, sir. So there are a few questions in the chat box, which I'll ask one by one. So the first question is from Ravindra Jena. Sir, is it audible?
Yes.
Yeah.
It is audible.
Yeah. First question is from Rabindra Jena. He wants to know, is Spinoza's pantheism satisfactory?
Spinoza equates the God or substance with the nature. That means pantheism is the relationship of God with the world. So pantheism, pan, is derived from two syllables, that is pan means all, theos means God. So Spinoza, from this statement, world is God and God is world, Spinoza is out and out pantheist. He is in favor of pantheism, sometimes he is in favor of pantheism, and sometimes he is in favor of theism. He wants to bridge the gap, but the gap is not soluble. In his philosophy.
Yeah. Then the second question is from Niranjan Behera. So he wants to know, both Spinoza and Sankara are monotheists, but is there any difference between Spinoza and Sankara's philosophy?
Definitely. Both of them have the idealistic leaning. Shankara is also talking of Nirguna Brahman is non-dualistic, because any description of Brahman is not sufficient to describe the concept of Brahman. Brahman is all-inclusive, and therefore it cannot be described positively. So, but in case of Spinoza, the case is also different. He is adopting monism. So monism is not the same thing as non-dualism. So he also adopted the philosophy, the method of neti, neti, neti. Shankara is adopting this method, neti, neti, neti. And here Spinoza is saying that every determination is a negation. He followed this principle throughout his writings. Therefore, this is the fundamental, I find this is the fundamental difference between Spinoza's philosophy and Shankara's philosophy in itself.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Then the next question is from Sasmita Bisoi. She wants to know, God is world and all the world is God. How?
Spinoza is equating God with the world. Therefore, he is said as an atheist. And this is sometimes Spinoza is accepting this because his logic, his logic tends him to do so, because Spinoza, the primary aim of philosophy is not logic. The main interest of Spinoza is ethics, how to make a man a moral being.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Then the next question, she wants to know, if there is no relative substance, according to Spinoza, so thought and extension are what type of substance? They don't depend upon God.
Thought and extension are not, according to Descartes, thought and extensions are relative substances. According to Spinoza, they are not the substance which doesn't satisfy this definition of substance is given by Descartes. Is not applicable to this. So relative substance is a contradiction in terms. So according to Spinoza, substance can be, so far as the definition of substance is concerned, substance is the being which is dependent on nothing and on which everything depends. It is self-caused, it is uncaused cause, it is the effects of all else, which presupposes nothing. Substance doesn't presuppose nothing, but it still constitutes the presupposition of all that is. So it is a pure being, it is a primal being. So the though he equates substance with the world, therefore he is also facing many difficulties in his life, in his philosophy. But he is bound to equate substance with the world. He equates nature. So God and world. There are three terms in his philosophy: nature, God, and substance. Nature and God are found in his early writings, but substance is found in his latter. Substance is in his latter period. So he equates substance with nature, and he equates substance with. That is the reason why he equates nature and substance with nature. Thanks.
Yeah, no such question I'm seeing. She has asked the same question in another words also. So any question from audience, you can unmute yourself and can ask your question. If you have any. No, sir.
Hello.
Yes, Aditya Narayan Bari, you can say. You can ask your question. Sorry, you are not audible clearly. You can type
your question.
Hello.
Yes, sir. Also,
yes.
My question.
Yeah.
Sir, why Spinoza?
Why Spinoza? Sorry, you are not audible.
Sir, why? Yes, sir.
So,
his question is reflected in the chat box. His question is reflected.
No. chat box. Okay. Then I'm asking. So, Ratnakar sir. So next question is from Aditya Narayan Parikh. He wants to know why Spinoza avoided the metaphysical thought.
I have already in the, my lecture last time, the last portion of my lecture is concentrated on that. So, like Buddhism, Spinoza thinks that the logical analysis of anything doesn't purify the self of anybody. So, logical analysis is not given importance in his philosophy. His ethical considerations are primary because it is his approach is from the standpoint of conduct. Eternal bliss follows from the pursuit of one thing and which exists by itself, which is in itself. So this, that is the ideal of human life. The ideal of human life was very much highlighted by his philosophy. Therefore, ethical considerations are given topmost priority in Spinoza's philosophy. And logical considerations are not so much important as far as the texts are concerned.
So thank you very much, sir. So these are all the questions. So it is now over to Kailas, sir.
Is hello, Prabhuji Bhutto. Thanks to Ratnakar sir and others. Question raises.
Okay. So it's been very fascinating and very engaging lecture. Thank you very much, sir, for delivering a nice presentation on Spinoza's philosophy. Thank you all who have raised your question here in the chat box. And thank you all for your patience hearing. So, thanks to all.
Okay, thanks to Devasis for your lucid and humble way of moderating this session. I appreciate your clarity and presentation of the questions. Thank you very much. Now we have to move to the second session. Hello. In the second session. Hello.
Yes, sir.
I have something to say. Thanks to the audience and their valuable participation enriched my thinking, and I will think about this problem, problems of philosophy. And I am very much interested. I am observing each and every seminar, a webinar. That is from Indian philosophy and history of philosophy. History of I think this is a very very good attempt by Professor Pramod Kumar Das. Because Pramod Kumar Das is interested for the students as well as the audience. He is prescribing the course of plus three students, and the plus three students will be definitely benefited by these deliberations. Thank you all.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. And Ratnakar, sir, I have to say one more thing to you, that really you are an inspiration for us, because whenever I opened the Google Meet app, I found the first name of yours. And really, you are so punctual and so attentive to this lecture that I'm very much really impressed by this personality of yours. So this shows how you were committed to the philosophy family and philosophy as a whole. So you are really an inspiration for us. Thank you very much, sir.
And now,
thank you.
Second session. In the second session, Professor Dr. Umnan Rao is with us, and he will also speak on the philosophy of Spinoza, particularly on pantheism and parallelism. Okay, before the presentation of his lecture, it's my privilege and opportunity to present his brief introduction. Though I have given his introduction many times, that is in this webinar, still then, that is, I have to speak something on his introduction, on his academic career. Dr. K. Umnan Rao is presently working as an associate professor of philosophy in Niranjan Government Women's College, Asker. Having a brilliant academic career, Dr. Rao did his master's in philosophy and MPhil, MPhil in philosophy from University of Delhi, you know. Okay. Then he obtained his doctoral degree from Sambalpur University on the topic analytical approach to the concept of reality. After being served for 1.5 years in Punjab National Bank as a bank officer, he joined Odisha Educational Service in 1999 as an assistant professor in GM College, Sambalpur. Now currently he is working as associate professor in Niranjan Government Women's College, Asker. So he is a brilliant teacher. He is a brilliant scholar, and he has reflected his excellency in asking philosophical questions. That is in different seminars and conferences in Odisha and outside Odisha. And we have witnessed how scholarly approach he has in different seminars. To his credit, Dr. Rao has authored more than 14 books, which have been very much popular among the students of logic and philosophy in our state and in the country. And whenever Dr. Rao goes to any college, the students like to see him. That how Dr. Omnarana is, or how he is writing so many books which have been very popular among the students. And I can recite some of his books which are very popular among the students, Plus Two Logic, Part 1 and Part 2. These two books that is have been appreciated by the students of logic and the teachers of philosophy. Then System of Indian Philosophy, it is also a very lovable book among the students, and the students are following it in UG and PG level. Then Philosophy of Religion, when the students do not understand the book that is the Philosophy of Religion written by John Heath, then that as an alternative source, the students like to read the Philosophy of Religion written by Dr. Rao. It has very much popular among the students and among the teachers of philosophy in Odisha. Then you can have his book that is Introduction to Applied Ethics. And we are also reading his books, Critical Thinking, Applied Reasoning. This book is very much popular among the students who are appearing OPSC and other exams. And you can also appreciate another book, Introduction to Gandhian Study. Then he has also written the Introduction to Ethics, which has been very popular among the students of philosophy in UG class. And he has also many other books. Due to paucity of time, it is not possible to recite the names of his books. It is not possible for me to read out all his publications here. He has a long list of publications which have been published in different journals of the nation and outside the nation. Being a brilliant scholar in philosophy, he has participated in a number of national and international seminars and workshops where his scholarly articles have been reflected, have been published, and gained popularity. Then with this, I would like to continue. I won't like to continue mentioning the introduction of Dr. Rao. Now I invite and welcome Dr. Rao to start his lecture on Spinoza's philosophy, particularly on pantheism and parallelism. Welcome, sir. Welcome, Dr. Rao.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Dr. Kailas Mahana, sir, for your nice words. I thank you a lot for collecting the information on me and putting before all the participants. I don't know how much my books are followed by the students, but it was always my effort to write things. I try to utilize the best part of my life in writing books and articles. That's how I find pleasure in doing things. But I'm never concerned about how far they are reaching people. It has to be decided by all of you. But my aim is to use my time in the best possible way in whatever little understanding that I have in writing things. Thank you, sir, for your words. Respected admin, convener and host of Philosophy Family, Professor Pramod Kumar Das, coordinator of this session, Dr. Kailas Maharana, Dr. Indu Khanduri Madam, whom I see in the list. Namaskar, Madam. I see respected co-speaker, Dr. Gajendra Sir, the moderator of this session, Sri Devasis Sadangi, senior faculty members attending this webinar, and all the participants attending this webinar. I feel it's a privilege on my part to be invited for the second time in the webinar series on Western philosophy. I thank Philosophy Family for this. I'm asked to talk on the mind-body parallelism and the pantheism of Benedict Spinoza. Before talking about the mind-body parallelism, I should prepare a basic framework into the system of philosophy that we see in Spinoza and how did he start up. So what I see is something like this. We see rationalism as being initiated by René Descartes. But Spinoza gave a developed form to rationalism that was initiated by Descartes. Like Descartes, Spinoza was attracted to the sort of certainty that we have in mathematics. This is the reason why he wanted to establish philosophy in the lines of certainty, as we see in mathematics. So what he does is something like this. It starts with the fundamental axioms or definitions and deduces from them mathematically all possible conclusions about the different aspects of nature. Spinoza's philosophy is sometimes described as mathematical mysticism because he employed the mathematical method in understanding substance, attributes, and modes. He was greatly influenced by the techniques of geometry, and he saw geometry to have analytic and synthetic method. The analytic method in geometry aims to discover the primary truths, and the synthetic method in geometry aims to deduce the secondary truths or certain conclusions from the primary truths. So he was greatly influenced by the geometric method. Now, he starts his method with the definition of substance. He defines substance as that which is in itself and conceived through itself. So definition of substance, he defines substance as something like this. So substance is that which is in itself and conceived through itself. But he was, when he refers back to the pages on what is the position of substance as dealt by the earlier philosophers, he finds that Descartes has made a discussion, an elaborated discussion on substance, and he sees that Descartes talks of three substances. The other two substances being mind and body. But Spinoza was all in favor of one and only one substance. So when he looks to what Descartes has done, he finds in having three substances, he takes mind and body to be relative substances and makes those relative substances dependent on the substance. But Spinoza was not happy with this format. You see, Descartes sees mind and body as contradictory to one another, diametrically opposed to one another, and at the same time, that he takes mind and body to be substances and also calls them relative substances and also tries to bring about a relation between these two relative substances by putting forth what is called as interactionism. So overall, Spinoza was not happy with the dualistic philosophy of Descartes and the method of interactionism that he suggested to show a sort of interaction between mind and body. So what are the problems that he saw in Descartes? And these problems in Descartes that Spinoza saw made him to put forth what is called as parallelism or mind-body parallelism, much different from what we see in Descartes. Now, when Spinoza sees in Descartes that mind and body are relative substances, to say mind and body as substances and also say that they are relative substances, Spinoza is a problem. When we say mind and body are substances, these substances will try to limit each other, and in a process the very essence of substantiality will be lost. So the very idea of considering mind and body as substances was not acceptable to Spinoza. I repeat, because if you take mind and body as substances, then these substances will limit each other and the very essence of substantiality will be lost therein. Spinoza was also against naming mind and body as relative substances. He was not comfortable with the usage of word relative with substances. He says that to say substances as relative is self-contradictory. We should go away with this doctrine of relative substances. That's how he's not comfortable with saying that mind and body are relative substances. Now, if we look at mind and body, the exposition of mind and body that was presented by Descartes, Spinoza finds that Descartes comes with, in order to explain the relationship between mind and body, he comes up with what is called as interactionism. Now, Spinoza says, if Descartes comes up with interactionism and you say mind and body, they interact, they must be interacting at some point. If they interact at a point, we'll discuss what is that point. If they interact at any point, then the entire dualistic philosophy of mind and body is lost. The entire dualism is lost because you are bringing mind and body together. When you bring mind and body together, the entire duality that you consider is lost. So this is how he says dualist, if you talk of interactionism, then the dualistic sense that you are speaking of, the dualism that you are speaking of, is lost. Now, Spinoza also sees how can, you see, Descartes has given a list of attributes to mind and body and says, these are the attributes, these are the things that we associate with mind, and these are the things that we associate with the body, that we all know that that has been discussed at length yesterday. Now, seeing all these things, Descartes says that mind and body are diametrically opposed. Having said that mind and body are diametrically opposed, now he says, mind and body, they interact in the pineal gland of the brain. Now, once you say that mind and body interact in the pineal gland, Spinoza says that you are localizing the mind. But mind, as you know, is non-localized. Body is localized. But mind is not localized at all. But once you talk of interactionism, once you localize the mind in the pineal gland, while explaining interactionism, you are localizing the mind. So the duality that you are talking of, as I said earlier, the duality that he is talking of merges into a unity. Now, another problem arises in this sense is, if suppose say we go on with interactionism of Descartes, we come across asking what sort of relationship is this, since we have two contradictory things in the lines of Descartes, mind and body. Mind is mental, body is material. So what's up, and Descartes speaks of interactionism. So if we go with interactionism, the question that comes is, what sort of relationship is this? What sort of relationship interactionism is? Is it mental? Number one. Second, is it physical? Number three, is it either mental or physical? Number four, is it both physical and mental? Straightforward way I say that we cannot go with the fourth, because we cannot go with contradictory things. The relationship cannot be both physical and mental. So we are taking away the fourth option. So we are left with three options. The first option is, if you go on to say that the relationship between mind and body in interactionism is mental, then if the relationship is said as mental, then the body has to be explained in the terms of the mind. I repeat, if the relationship is said to be mental, then body has to be explained in terms of the mind. Number two, if the relationship is physical or bodily, then the mind has to be explained in terms of the body. So neither of them is a comfortable position. Now, if we go with the third option, the relationship is either physical or mental. If we go by this third option, that the relationship is either mental or physical, then two possibilities arise. The first possibility is that mind and body are not independent. If you say the relationship is either physical or mental, then the first possibility that comes before us is that mind and body are not independent. But Descartes says mind and body are independent of one another. Now, second option, or the second possibility that we can have, is that no relationship can be established between mind and body. So we see problems in the Descartesian conception of mind-body problem. So Spinoza tries to give a new direction to this mind-body problem and suggests and comes with what is called as parallelism. So still there are issues which go against dualism that will take time, but still, in short, let me tell you. You see, in Descartes, mind and body are taken to be independent. If mind is taken as independent, then one mind can function in different bodies, because mind is independent. or since body is independent and mind is independent, one body can harbor many minds. So that is another problem that we can see. Okay, so having so many problems in the Descartesian format of mind-body dualism and interactionism, Spinoza rejects the dualism of Descartes and comes up with parallelism or mind-body parallelism. In mind-body parallelism, Spinoza, what we see is that mind and body, or thought and extension, are taken as the two attributes of the substance. Spinoza, as we know, he speaks of many attributes of the substance, but we can only know two attributes. One is the attribute of thought and another is the attribute of extension. These are the two attributes that we can know. So Spinoza says mind and body, they constitute the attributes, or that they constitute the aspects of one and the only one substance. He says that mind and body, they coexist, but they do not interact. They coexist, but they do not interact. They influence each other. Mind and body, they influence each other, but they do not meet. So, how do they move? Spinoza says that mind and body run parallel to one another. Mind and body, they run parallel to one another, or thought and extension run parallel to one another. Okay, so as I said, thought and extension are the attributes of God, and God can be expressed in any of the ways. He can be expressed by the attribute of thought, or he can be expressed by the attribute of extension from two different standpoints. So, but he says, mind and body, they are the inseparable aspects of one and the same substance. Like the way, if you take a lens, we can see the concave surface and the convex surface in the lens. And we cannot separate the concave and the convex surfaces. In the same manner, mind and body, they are inseparable, but they don't interact. They influence one another, and they run parallel to one another. They can be taken as the two rays of one and the same light. They can be taken as mind and body. They can be taken as two rays of one and the same light. They may appear as if they meet, but they do not meet. They do not interact. They do not meet. We can understand something like this. Mind and body may be taken as the parallel lines of a railway track, the parallel tracks of a railway track. So we see they are parallelly going, but at a distance we feel as if they meet, but actually they don't meet. So the mind and body, they run parallel to one another. It may appear as if they meet, but actually mind and body, they influence one another, but they do not interact, or they do not meet one another. So, having said this, Spinoza says, substance or God appears as infinite extension from one angle. He also appears as infinite intellect from another angle. So, we see both these aspects in the substance without any contradiction. So the two aspects can be understood something like this. One is the aspect of thought, another is the aspect of extension. Now Spinoza says they are the two aspects of one and the same substance. Now we may have a problem as to how they are to be accounted for. Let us think of something like this. Suppose we have a triangle in reality, and we carry an idea of a triangle in the mind. So the idea of a triangle in the mind and a triangle outside, they speak of. They speak of the triangle. But what is the difference? The difference is, when you talk of the idea of the triangle, it is talked of from the standpoint of thought. When you talk of the triangle in reality, it is taken from the standpoint of extension. So in parallelism, we have a sort of correspondence between thought and extension, and they run parallel to one another. Now, he says, to every mode of extension, there is a corresponding mode of thought. So this is parallelism that we can see in Spinoza. Now, while advocating parallelism, Spinoza excludes both materialism and also idealism, since matter cannot explain mind and mind cannot explain matter. So he excludes both idealism and materialism. So thus, to avoid the problems of dualism and interactionism that we see in Descartes, Spinoza has initiated parallelism, or it's called parallelistic monism. Okay. In parallelism, we can see that it neither reduces matter to mind like spiritualism, nor it reduces mind to matter as in materialism. But parallelism regards both mind and matter to be real. So, you see, in Descartes, what we saw, that mind and body are distinct, they are independent substances, though relative to one another, they are independent to one another, and though relative in relation to the substance, but we see a different sort of thing in the parallelism of Spinoza. In the parallelistic monism of Spinoza, mind and body, or mind and matter, are not two distinct and independent substances. Mind and body are not distinct and independent substances, but they are the two parallel attributes of one and the same God or same substance. But they are the parallel attributes of one and the same substance. He says, for every unit of extension in the universe, there is a corresponding unit of consciousness. And similarly, for every unit of consciousness, there is a corresponding unit of extension in the universe. Okay. Now, so what you see, there is a correspondence between thought and extension. For every thought, there is extension. Okay, so thus, what you see, that parallelistic monism explains the relation between mind and body by inhering. So it explains mind and body by seeing it as inhering parallelly in one and the same substance. Thus, we can see in parallelistic monism of Spinoza that a compromise is arrived between dualism and monism by combining the dualism of attributes of mind and body with the monism of the substance. That is, the dualism that we see in Descartes was blended in the substance, and the unity is arrived in the substance. So there is no more duality, because the mind and body dualism that we see in Descartes, they are seen as the parallel attributes of the substance and not different from the substance. So though mind and body, they don't have independent existence apart from the substance, they constitute the attributes of the substance. So we arrive at a monism in the philosophy, a parallelistic monism in the philosophy of Benedict Spinoza. So he also says, we can understand one more mind-body parallelism, something like this also. Suppose we want to explain something. Suppose I am trying to explain my understanding in English. Somebody may explain the same understanding in some other language. So the languages are different, but the explanation is maybe the same. So mind and body, they also run like that. They run parallel. They mean the same thing, because they are the attributes, because there is one is the reflection of the other. As I said, that the idea of a circle and a circle, they imply or mean the same thing, but one is in the extended form and the other is in a thought form. One is in the mind and the other is body. So that is how mind and body, they run parallel to one another without interacting with one another, constituting as the attributes of one and the same substance. Okay, so having said all this, Spinoza goes on to say that the structure in which the mind and body operate, that is also same. I repeat, the structure in which the mind operates and the body operates, the structure is also same, because they are corresponding to one another. Then he says that man is the mode of the substance attribute of thought and extension. So this is how this is how we can think of the mind-body parallelism in Spinoza. But many problems arise. What are they? You see, when we are taking only mind and body as the attributes of the substance, but Spinoza talks of infinite attributes of substance. But what are those infinite attributes? If the thought can understand extension, the other attribute, why thought cannot conceive of, think of other attributes that are there in the substance? Apart from thought and extension, what are the other attributes? Spinoza is silent on that. He says there are infinite attributes, but he says we only know two attributes. That is attribute of thought and extension. No doubt, Spinoza has tried to answer this difficulty by saying that man is an embodied spirit. That's why he can only know these two attributes. Other attributes he cannot know. This is how he tries to escape. But still the problem persists. If at all you say there are infinite attributes, you have to list them. If you are not listing them, don't say there are infinite attributes and try to explain everything by, say, this mind and body as attributes, like the way we see in Ramanuja, that he takes three realities: Ishwara, the world of matter, and the world of soul. So by taking these three realities, he could explain the entire structure of reality. So there is nothing left outside it. So we see Ramanuja is more consistent than the Spinoza's exposition, because he talks of infinite attributes and he says these infinite attributes cannot be known. Only mind can know, that only we can know thought and extension. This is how the mind and body parallelism, though looks very much consistent in explaining the relationship between mind and body, in saying that mind and body, they constitute the attributes of one and only substance, they do not interact, they run parallel to one another, they influence one another without interacting one another. So this is how very nicely Spinoza has tried to make a balance between mind and body through his parallelistic monism. But the problems are many when we see the infinite attributes in Spinoza and he's silent on what those infinite attributes are. This is the first criticism that we can extend against the mind-body parallelism. The another criticism that we can extend is something like this. You see, the substance is said to have thought. The substance is said to have extension. So you see, thought is non-extended. Thought is non-extended. So, since the substance has thought and extension, the attributes of thought and extension, how can the substance be both extended and non-extended? You see, we say thought and extension are the attributes. They run parallel to one another. Thought is non-extended. So, the problem arises is, how can substance be both extended and non-extended? So, this is another problem that we see. But still a greater problem was found in taking the Spinoza's position further by Samuel Alexander when he says mind and body are identical. He held that mind is extended. But there are many problems associated with this conception, so we should not turn into that. Now, moving further to the mind-body parallelism and the problems that are linked with it, we find another criticism, that is, Spinoza talks of infinite attributes. He says we only know two attributes, thought and extension, and he says the thought and extension run parallel to one another. Well, he is silent on the other attributes that which I have already pointed out. Now, he is also silent whether these attributes also run parallel to one another or not. So that is another problem. First thing is, he is silent about the infinite attributes. What are the infinite attributes? He only speaks of thought and extension. Apart from being silent on the infinite attributes, what are the infinite attributes? He is also silent about the nature of those infinite attributes, whether they are parallel, whether they run parallel to one another like mind and body or not. So that is another problem that we find in the mind-body parallelism in Spinoza. There is still one more problem that we can find in Spinoza is that he says wherever there is thought, there is extension, and wherever there is extension, there is thought. You see, this position is again problematic in number of ways. Suppose I have a thought of a golden mountain, but can I have such a golden mountain in reality? No, you cannot have that. So again, this position of Descartes, that for every unit of thought, there is a corresponding unit of extension and vice versa, is also problematic in the mind-body parallelism. Because we can think of many things which are not in reality. We can think of a sky flower, sky lotus. We can think of a flying horse, a golden mountain. And there is no correspondence in reality. So here also the mind and mind-body parallelism that we find in Spinoza falls into a problem. So this is all about the mind-body parallelism in Spinoza. Since the time is short, I have to limit the talk till this. I'm assigned with another topic, that is the pantheism of Spinoza. Pantheism. So before understanding what is pantheism, let us try to understand what is theism. Theism, you see, is derived from the Greek word theos, which means God. And theism is Godism. Theism is Godism, or a science of God. Theism is a science of God. Now, there are various forms of theism. We can talk of various forms of theism. Monotheism, deism, polytheism, pantheism, panentheism, henotheism, or cathenotheism. There are various forms of theism that we all know. We are concerned with pantheism here because Spinoza is taken to be a pantheist, and we have to see what pantheism means. As I said you, theism is a belief in God. And if you say deism, in deism we see two realities. One is God and the world. When we come to polytheism, we believe in the existence of a number of gods in polytheism. Now when we come to pantheism, it is a belief that God is everything and everything is God. Now when we come to panentheism, it is a belief that the whole existence is in God. Panentheism is a position that whole existence is in God. Then when we come to henotheism or cathenotheism, it is a belief in a multiplicity of gods, but each of the gods turning to be the highest at the point of worship. So henotheism or cathenotheism, Max Muller says, it is the belief pattern that we have in Hinduism, henotheism or cathenotheism. What is it? Let me repeat this because this is very important concept. Henotheism or cathenotheism, it is phrased by Max Muller, who says, this is very much specific to Hinduism. What is it? Cathenotheism or henotheism is a belief in a number of gods and each of the gods turning to be the highest at the point of worship. Suppose I am worshipping Lord Ganesha, so Ganesha is now the highest god for me. If I am worshipping Durga, Durga is the highest god for me at that point of time. So there is a belief pattern wherein we have a multiplicity of gods, a belief in a multiplicity of gods, but each of the gods turning to be the highest at the point of worship. So this is what is henotheism or cathenotheism. We are not interested in that. We are interested in the pantheism of Spinoza. So as I said you, pantheism is a belief that everything is God and God is everything. In the pantheism of Spinoza, God is impersonal. In the pantheism of Spinoza, God is impersonal. We find in pantheism that every individual entity, conscious or non-conscious, is God. Even an individual attempting to know the nature of God is also a mode of God himself. So what we see is everything is God and God is everything. Now what we see is in pantheism, in the philosophy of Spinoza, is that the world is just an appearance of God who is immanently present everywhere. For example, just as say we take a number of clay pots as different forms and shapes, okay, so they are all the forms of one and the same mud and clay. We have different pots of different shapes and sizes, but what are they in reality? What are they in true sense? They are, in the true sense, the mud and clay out of which they are born, out of which they are formed. So he says God is something like that. Though we see multiplicity in the world, but what we see in this multiplicity? We see God, because God is everything and everything is God. So in that line of thinking, he says that different living beings and non-living beings are the modes of one and the same substance. The various things, various entities, both living and non-living, they are the modes of one and the same substance. So we see a sort of unity in the conception of the world in Spinoza. He again says, apart from the substance, nothing exists. Apart from the substance, nothing exists. And he says, if you think of, is there anything that is outside substance? Spinoza says, no. There is nothing that is outside substance, not even empty space. So, the substance is all-encompassing. It is the sole reality. We cannot think of anything, not even empty space, outside the substance. So, he says, thus he says, substance is only real. And he adds that all the finite things in the world are annulled or suppressed in the existence of God. All the finite things, they are suppressed or they are annulled in the existence of God. Now, how does he account for this? He says, all the multiplicity and the variety of things that we see, they are the manifestations of one ultimate reality, and that is the substance. You see, from the psychological point, no doubt, we see multiplicity. But he says, from the psychological point only, we have to see the unity that flows in all the things that we see, both living and non-living. While coming to man, he says, whatever happens in the mind, happens in the body, that is the mind influences the body, and the body too influences the mind. They don't interact, they influence. So this again shows that there is one principle underlying both. He says there is only one energy in the mind-body parallelism, or in mind-body influencing one another, there is only one sort of energy, that is fluid, either from mind to body or from body to mind. Okay, so there is one underlying principle even in the mind-body, mind and body. So that's how he tries to see a sort of unity in all. Now, he says only the ultimate substance, that is God, is free and self-dependent. Now, we cannot talk of more than one substance like the way Descartes has done, because any idea of more than one substance is to limit the substance and make the substance dependent. But actually, substance is something which is primary, which is basic, which is independent, which is eternal. So the very idea of the substance would be lost if you think of a second substance. So Spinoza was all in favor of one ultimate substance who is free and who is self-dependent. So thinking in this line, thought and extension are not separate substances. They are two attributes of one and the same substance, which I had already discussed at length in the earlier section on while discussing mind-body parallelism. Now, coming to modes, he says, all living beings are the modes of the conscious attribute of substance. I repeat, all living beings on the planet are the modes of the conscious attribute of substance, and all non-living things are the modes of extension of the substance. So this is how he tries to see a sort of unity in all. He tries to reduce everything to the substance. Even thought and extension are taken as the attributes of God. Okay, and these attributes cannot be thought apart from the substance. Okay, now coming to modes, as I have said, that the finite modes, say the living beings and the non-living beings, the living beings are the modes of the conscious attribute of the substance, and the non-living modes are the modes of are the modes of the attribute of extension of the substance. Now, while talking about modes, we find a sort of confusion in Spinoza. Now he says at one place he says modes are unreal, and at the other place he says modes are real. So it creates a sort of problem in the minds of the readers at exactly what Spinoza is talking about modes, whether they are real or whether they are fictitious or they are unreal. Now, since everything is God, so modes are also God, and this being so, modes are eternal and real. This is one position that we can clearly say, because in the pantheistic position of Spinoza, since everything is God and God is everything, so modes are also are in God. We cannot think of modes apart from God. So this being so, the modes are also eternal and real. So how to justify that the modes are real? How to justify the eternal nature of the modes? Now you see, he says that every finite thing results from the infinite totality. However, this infinite totality says that is as the naturator, as infinite mode is directly caused by God, because every mode follows from God. So when he says every mode follows from God, we cannot think of mode as unreal. Mode has to be real. Now, as I already said, modes cannot be conceived to exist apart from the substance or without the substance. If this is so, since the substance is real, the modes must be real, because nothing falls outside the substance, everything is substance, so the modes must be real. So this is how we can say the modes are real. But there is a problem in Spinoza when he says modes are also unreal. What does this mean? When he says modes are unreal, he says about the finite things. Modes means, again, we can talk of modes as the finite things that are created by some other finite things. Suppose we have, say, X and Y. Suppose you say X is one thing and Y is one thing. And suppose, say, X is created by Y and not by God, or X did not follow from God. So when we take things in that light, that the modes, one mode is following from some other mode, and that mode is not seen as following from God, if one sees mode in that sort, in that sense, then we have to think of, then the problem arises that the modes are considered unreal. But in the real sense, if we go deeper into the structure of the conceptions that we have in Spinoza, we can find that modes are to be taken as real, because they participate in the nature, the very nature of God. So what we see is modes to be real in one sense. I have explained how modes are real, because modes cannot be conceived apart from the substance, since everything follows from God. Everything is in God. Everything is God, and God is everything. So modes being a part and parcel of God, so modes have to be real. It is only when modes are taken as being created by some other modes, when one mode is thought to be created by some other mode, then only we can, the question of reality of that mode arises. In that sense, mode is said to be unreal. Otherwise, modes are real. So how to explain this? Spinoza says that a mode is real when it participates in the nature of God. I repeat, a mode is real when it participates in the nature of God. But when it is determined by some other finite mode or some other finite thing, then the mode is unreal. So this is what I was saying. Now, that we see that Spinoza has somehow suggested a contradictory position of modes, but this can be resolved. As I said, a bit of resolution that I have already explained, let me clarify it furthermore. What is that? Spinoza, in order to come out of this, the nature of modes, whether they are real or unreal, he makes a distinction between the actual and the real. I repeat, Spinoza makes a distinction between the actual and the real. A thing is said to be actual if it is known through the sense organs. A thing is said to be actual if it can be known through the sense organs, or if it is created by some other thing or mode. I repeat, a thing is actual if it is or if it can be known through the sense organs, or it is created by some other mode or thing. But how to see the mode in the real sense? Now he says a mode is real or a thing is real if it is permanent and eternal. How can that mode be permanent and eternal? So when a mode participates in the nature of God, then that mode is real. So we have to understand something like this. Okay. So in a line, let me summarize this, something like this. Modes are actual but not real if we grasp them through our senses. But the modes that participate in the nature of God, they are real. Okay. Now we can say now that Spinoza is pantheistic, since he negates the actuality of things that we see, the actuality of modes that we see, and ascribes to the real modes in the substance. Let me repeat this line again. Spinoza is pantheistic, since he negates, he brackets out, he takes away the actuality of the things or the modes, and ascribes real to the modes in the substance. That's how we see a pantheistic trend in Spinoza. Now, if you look at the doctrine of infinite modes, infinite attributes, what we can see is Spinoza was all after reconciling the attributes and the modes in one and the only one infinite substance. So that is all in Spinoza. So that is the sole reality. Everything is negated. I mean, negated in the sense, the reality has to be understood with reference to the substance. When you talk of attributes, if you talk of modes, they have to be talked in terms of the substance. Now he says, he asserts that God is nature, because everything is God and God is everything. He says, God is nature and nature is God. He takes two positions of God. One is natura naturata and other is natura naturans. Natura naturata, he looks down as something when we take all the things as the aggregate, and natura naturans as something when everything follows from the nature of God. But somehow he is opposed to natura naturata. In a later analysis, we can find that everything, Spinoza wants to merge in natura naturans. Because natura naturata, if you take as the aggregate, if you take natura naturata as the aggregate of all finite things, and those finite things have to be negated in the have to be negated, and only the reality of the substance is to be ascribed. So Spinoza asserts that natura naturata is to be merged in natura naturans, which means the negation of all finite things. Okay, so now let us try to understand Spinoza from two standpoints. One from the temporal standpoint and another from the eternal standpoint. From the temporal standpoint, the attributes and modes are real, as we see in our everyday life. But from the eternal standpoint, Spinoza says that the attributes and modes are in God and they cannot be taken away from the God. They cannot be seen away from the God. They are a part and parcel of God. So what we see attributes and modes to be real from a temporal standpoint. But if we go by the eternal standpoint, he says that attributes and modes are the intellectual superimpositions. They are to be seen as one with the substance. They have to be seen one with the substance, not distinct from that. So, that's what we see in Spinoza is that he merges all the plurality in the world into a sort of unity. So, all plurality from an eternal standpoint, attributes, modes, everything out there is merged into a sort of unity in the substance. That the plurality is lost and unity is established in Spinoza. Spinoza says that plurality is an illusion. And he also says that a man of knowledge knows that multiplicity is not real. Unity is real. And again he says, let me reassert. So what we see in him is that everything is God and God is everything. Let me take one example. Like the way we see one example concerning the clay pots I have already given, let me take another example. Suppose we take a number of golden ornaments. Now, we see a number of golden ornaments in different forms and different shapes, but they are the modes of one and the same substance. So, distinct from the substance, away from the substance, nothing is real. If you want to ascribe reality, we can ascribe reality only to God, and God alone is real. That's how Spinoza arrives at pantheism. In his pantheistic position, sometimes he is referred to Spinoza is called as a God intoxicated Jew. Spinoza is sometimes referred as God intoxicated Jew because he had immense faith in God. And some thinkers, they say that the Spinoza's entire position leads to atheism. You see two different positions. In one position, some say that God, Spinoza by his method, has immense faith in God and tries to see everything in God and God in everything. That's how he is highly religious. Okay. The other position is some say that when he says God is everything and everything is God, and if that everything is nature, then Spinoza's position reduces to atheism. So this is one problem. But however, Spinoza tries to get rid of this problem, or the problem of being attacked, of being atheistic, or his position being subjected to atheism.
If God is emphasized, and it is seen that nature has no existence independent of God, okay, then it will not amount to atheism. So what I say to the critics, Spinoza tries to answer that if God is emphasized and it is said that everything in nature or the nature itself has to be dependent on God for its existence, then there is no way to atheism. And we can establish, we can see Spinoza as God intoxicated. However, having said the pantheism, having established the pantheistic position of Spinoza, it would be incomplete if we don't look into the criticisms that have been advanced against his pantheistic position. There may be a number of criticisms. I have with me one or two criticisms that I have already talked of during my discussion. Still, we can speak of some criticisms that are advanced against his position. Now, some critics say, the modern thinkers, they say, by merging the world in God, by saying everything is God, we arrive at a cosmism. We arrive at a cosmism, which is contrary to the modern scientific concepts. If you say everything is God, so we arrive at a cosmism, which is much against the current trend or the modern science. This is another criticism. Still more criticisms, but we can say, though Spinoza is said as God-intoxicated Jew, but some say that Spinoza's pantheism is contrary to his religion and ethics. Why? Because in Spinoza, if the individuals or the human beings are mere modes of the conscious attribute of God, if the individuals or the human beings are just the modes of the conscious attribute of God, how can they be said as self-conscious or have religious or moral consciousness? Maybe I'm not clear in expressing. Let me express it again. He says the finite things, the conscious and the non-conscious, all are the modes of God, all are the modes of the attributes of God. Now, if the individuals, if the human beings are seen as the modes of the conscious attribute of the substance, if man is a mode of the conscious attribute of the substance, then how can he be said as self-conscious? How can he be said as morally or religiously conscious? So this is another problem. Now you see, in the beginning itself, I said, another criticism is something like this. In the beginning itself, I said, Descartes want to have a sort of certainty of mathematics in the area of philosophy. So he wants to see the order of the universe, a fixed order of the universe, in the lines of the laws or the fundamentals of mathematics. If this is so, if everything is structured in a mathematical pattern, then there would be no individual freedom. Some assert like this. One more criticism, I see a very good criticism that is advanced by some thinkers, that in pantheism, since everything is God and God is everything, in pantheism what we see that God is everything and everything is God. If God is everything and everything is God, that means everything out there in the world is perfect. I repeat, everything out there in the world is perfect because God is everything. If everything is perfect, there is no scope for evolution in this world. This world is already evolved. There is no scope for further evolution. So this is the biggest problem that we can have in taking in pantheism. So this is all about the pantheistic trend that we find in Spinoza. I have tried to establish pantheism. At the same time, I have tried to see what criticisms that can be extended against pantheism in order to be impartial in my attempt in looking at the pantheistic position of Spinoza. Earlier, I tried to see the mind-body parallelism in Spinoza. I took his position and also tried to critically look into his position. That's how I tried to make an effort to see Spinoza's conception as it is and also from the angle of a critic, so that we can have a balanced position on Spinoza. So this is all about my lecture on mind-body parallelism and pantheism in the philosophy of Spinoza. I thank everybody for giving me this opportunity and listening to me patiently. I thank everybody.
Friends, am I audible?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You are audible.
Friends, for the last 1 hour or more than that, we were listening to the brilliant lecture presented by Professor Dr. Om Narayana Rao, sir. Actually, it was a very brilliant presentation, and Dr. Rao has shown his scholarly aptitude, the way he has reflected Spinoza's conception on parallelism and pantheism. Today, he has very intelligently presented the logicality of parallelistic monism, which happens to be a development of Cartesian philosophy. And he has also made the pantheistic position, the pantheistic position of Spinoza. And he has very beautifully presented Spinoza's position in regard to pantheism, and he has also discussed how Spinoza has reduced everything to substance, and he has shown everything is God, everything is substance, everything is independent, everything is reduced to God. And he has very, very clearly clarified all the concepts of Spinoza so far as his parallelism and pantheism is concerned. And the presentation of Dr. Rao is open for discussion. Very brilliant presentation. He has cleared all the doubts. Still then, there are some doubts, some questions, some clarifications, and some compliments on the chat box. May I now request our moderator, Professor Devashish Sharangi, to reflect upon all the questions for the clear understanding of the participants. Over to Professor Devashish Sharangi.
Thank you very much, sir. So first, I would like to thank Professor K. M. Narayana Rao, sir, for his lucid explanation of Spinoza's philosophy. So, sir, there are a few questions from the audience. So I'll read them one by one. Sir, is it audible? Rao, sir. Hello.
You are audible.
Yeah. First question is from Pragya Das Kanungo. She wants to know, we all know that parallelism can be maintained when there is dualism. Spinoza also holds that mind and body are inseparable. Mind is body and body is mind. How can this view go with the parallelism? How Spinoza replied to this criticism anywhere? What will be your interpretation?
So, what Dr. Pragyan says, though Spinoza took the problem, the mind-body problem from Descartes and maintained that mind and body, they go parallel to one another, she has a problem in mind that the dualistic trend is still maintained. That is the problem that she carries. But that is not actually so. Why? This is because in Spinoza, what we see is mind and body, they are not taken to be independent, like the way we saw in Descartes. Mind and body are taken to be independent of one another. Okay, they are taken to be as substances. So reality is assigned to them in separation from the original substance. But this is not happening here. I repeat, mind and body are given the status of substances in Descartes. So the duality is there. But in Spinoza, mind and body, though we find them in Spinoza, they are taken as the attributes of one and the only one substance. Mind and body are not given the status of separate substances. They are taken as the attributes of thought and extension of the substance. In this way, a unity is brought in the philosophy of Spinoza. Now come to mind and body. I said during the course of my lecture that when we talk of a triangle and an idea of a triangle, they correspond or they refer to one and the same triangle. The difference is the idea is seen from the standpoint of thought. The idea of the triangle is seen from, the idea of the triangle is had from the standpoint of thought, and the triangle in reality is taken from the standpoint of extension. So this is what we see. So in maintaining parallelism and seeing mind and body as parallel to one another and being taken not as separate substances but as the attributes of one and the only one substance, all sorts of duality is merged into a unity in the substance, in Spinoza. This is my understanding of the subject.
Yeah, thank you very much, sir. Then the next question is from Dhirendra Behera. He wants to know, what is the essence of body?
You see, the essence of body is extension. What can you say of the body? The fundamental thing that we have of a body is extension. It has to be extended. And if I take from the understanding from Descartes, body can be localized. Body is non-conscious. Body can have shape. It can take different forms. When you talk of body, it is finite. It can be seen as opposed to mind, which cannot be seen, it cannot really be felt. You see, body can move, but its movement is limited. Okay, body is subjected to death and decay. So these are the things that we can talk of the body. So all this would constitute the tenets of the body. And those things all of us very well know.
Yeah. Then the next question is from Manasvini Patnaik. Actually, she has a doubt regarding henotheism and polytheism. Are they same or different?
No. Henotheism and polytheism are different. As I said, polytheism, poly means many. Theism means belief in God. So when we talk of polytheism, polytheism is a belief in a number of gods. Okay, so we have to limit that. Polytheism is a belief in a number of gods. And all of them are real. All of them are real. Okay, but when you come to henotheism or catholicism, the position is a bit different. It's an extension of polytheism. How? In catholicism or henotheism, what we see is that there is a belief in a number of gods, like in polytheism, here too, there is a belief in a number of gods or a multiplicity of gods. But the point is, each of the gods is taken to be the highest at the point of worship. What does that mean? When we take one god, we don't take all the gods at a time. Suppose if you are worshipping Lord Goddess Durga, then Goddess Durga is taken to be the highest. If you are going to a Shiva temple, Lord Shiva is then taken to be the highest god for you. If you are going to Vishnu temple, you are taking Lord Vishnu or Lord Balaji as the highest god. So you are taking all these gods without any contradiction. But what is the extension that we see in henotheism or catholicism that can be seen as an extension from polytheism is that here we take one god to be the highest at the time of his worship without having any sort of hatism or a sort of contradiction or a sort of difference to the belief in another god. That is, we believe in Catholicism, we believe in a number of gods, not in contradiction to one another. We believe in a number of gods in harmony with one another, and at the same time, we take each of the gods to be the highest at his point of worship. Okay, if you worship Shiva, Shiva is taken to be the highest. If you worship Ganesha, Ganesha is taken to be the highest. Without in any way distorting the highest nature of other gods. The only thing is, you take that god to be highest when you worship that. That the god you worship is taken to be the highest at the point of worship. Okay, this is all in henotheism or catholicism.
Yeah. Then the next question is from Sweta Rathor. She wants to know, is Spinoza justified in his explanation of external world of finite things? How could finite things follow from infinite? Is it convincing?
Okay. Now, in the morning, there was a Gita lecture presented by the Chinmay Mission, and it is hosted by our host of the philosophy family. We have a spiritual discourse every morning. The Swamiji, I had a similar question in the morning. How can, from Isopanishad and Vedantic standpoint, how can a Nirguna, Nirakara Brahman be the cause of Saguna Sakara Jagata? He said it is by Maya. Well, it is understood. I have a question to this, which I am not discussing here. Okay. So from the Indian standpoint, from the Vedantic standpoint, we can understand something like this. But since we are discussing Spinoza, how to establish the reality of the world. Now you see, Spinoza, what we see that the world can be divided into the living things and the non-living things. The living things are taken as the modes of the attribute of consciousness or thought. Okay, as I repeat, the living things are taken as the modes of the attribute of thought, and the non-living things are taken as the attributes of the mode of extension. But this thought and extension are taken as the attributes of God. What are these attributes of thought and extension? They are the attributes of the substance. And this substance is everything. And everything is substance. So, here in Spinoza, since everything is God, everything is Ishwaramaya, we cannot take anything away from him. We cannot think anything. We cannot think of anything apart from him. Because in his pantheistic position, as I said, everything is God and God is everything. We cannot separate God from nature or the world. So, this is how the reality is best established in the pantheistic position of Spinoza, that everything is God, if everything is, and God is real, and if God is real, everything that we see, look at, everything that we interact is real. Even though they are finite, since we have to see God in them. Because they are the modes of, even though they are finite, but they are the modes of the attributes of the substance. Since they are the modes of the attribute of substance, and the attributes cannot be seen apart from the substance, the attribute of thought and extension cannot be seen apart from the substance, so we cannot think of this world apart from the substance. So if the substance is real, then there is no question about the reality of the world.
Okay, the next question is from Ratnakar Gajendra sir. He wants to know, modes are related to substance as waves are to sea. Why Spinoza has said so? Please justify.
Yes. In Spinoza, if we take an analogy of waves to the sea, you see, are the waves permanent? You see, the modes are the modifications of the substance. The modes are the modification of the attributes of the substance. That, what are the modes? The modes are the modifications of the attributes of the substance. Do we find waves in a still sea? Do we find waves in a still sea? If the sea is still, suppose, say, imagine the sea is still. Do you find the waves? Or, let me place this in a different way. Can you think of a wave apart from the sea? Here also, you cannot. So wave is a wave, or a tide is a tide, in relation to the sea. We cannot think of a wave or a tide away from the sea. So, waves and tides, they are the modifications of that sea. And they have to merge with the sea. Suppose there is a wave, a patch of water found in the form of a wave. Can we say, oh, this patch of water appeared as a wave? You can never point. Once the wave comes, it has to fall down to be the sea again. Another wave comes to fall down to be the sea again. Can we separate the wave from the sea? No human effort, no effort can separate the wave from the sea. And we cannot even think of a wave distinct from the sea. That's how this has to be seen. The waves are the modes of the attribute of substance. So the waves are the waves in relation to the sea that cannot be thought of apart from the sea.
Thank you, sir. Next question is from Kailash, sir. He wants to know, what is the similarity and difference in the philosophy of Spinoza and Vedanta?
Now, if I, since you said Vedanta and Spinoza, the best position, the best parallel that we can draw between Spinoza and Vedanta philosophy is the philosophy of Ramanuja. The best parallel can be seen between Ramanuja and Spinoza, but with a difference, but lot of differences you can say. What are they? You see, the similarities that we can see is both, you see, they see a sort of unity in difference, in both of them we see a sort of unity in difference. Sometimes I feel that Spinoza has copied from Ramanuja and tried to expound this position. Sometimes I feel like that Spinoza has copied the philosophy of Ramanuja and tried to present himself in a bit different way. Otherwise, much that can be seen in Ramanuja can be seen in Spinoza, though there may be certain differences. Now, in Ramanuja, he talks of three realities. One is Ishvara, the second is the souls, and the third is the world. But in Spinoza, in order to overcome the mind-body problem, Spinoza took mind and body as the attributes of substance, and they did not give an independent status to the to mind and body. They are not called as substances. But the similarity being that in Spinoza, the souls and the world are taken as the attributes of the Ishvara. They constitute the organs of Ishvara. They constitute the body of Ishvara, the souls and the world. In a similar fashion to here also, we see Spinoza takes mind and body or thought and extension as the attributes of the substance. One thing that we see in Ramanuja, one more thing, important thing, he ascribes reality to the souls and also to the world separately and also in unity. Reality to the world and also to the souls separately and also together. Having said that world is real, having said that souls are real, he again tries to bring about a unity of the three, with the Ishvara constituting, with Ishvara constituting the constituting to be the fundamental substance or fundamental reality, and the world and the souls, they are taken as the attributes. And he says that the world, the souls and Ishvara are held together by a relationship called as Aprathaka Siddhi. Aprathaka Siddhi, it is an inseparable relation, it is a unique relation. An example to this relation cannot be found in any other thing. Like sign is unique, this relation of Aprathaka Siddhi that we find in Ramanuja is also unique. But that sort of thing we do not find in Spinoza. And at the same time, in order to get rid of interactionism, the problems related with dualism, he simply takes mind and body to be the attributes of substance, and he doesn't talk of a separate reality to the world or the thought and extension. He just sees them to be the attributes, and again says that everything is God and God is everything. So he covers, without assigning a special status of reality to mind and body or thought and extension, he covers everything by saying that God is everything and everything is God. So this is how we can see the way they come together and the way they fall apart. Still more can be done, can be seen, we can discuss as a separate paper. Comparison, a comparative account on Spinoza and Ramanuja can be taken as a very good topic for research. I remember while I was doing MPhil, one foreign scholar from Argentina was carrying on this a comparative study on Spinoza and Ramanuja for his MPhil degree in University of Delhi. Thank you.
Okay. Then the last question is from Manasini Patnaik. She wants to know, pantheism means everything is God and God is everything. And panentheism means whole existence is God. Then is there any difference between everything and whole existence?
Okay. Now you see, in pantheism, there is a difference on in. Suppose something like this. If I say X is Y, suppose I say something like, logically, let us try to understand this. Suppose I take a proposition X is Y. Then I say, take another proposition of the sort, X is in Y. Are they one and the same? No, they are not same. They are different. In the first proposition I said, X is Y. And in the second proposition, I say, X is in Y. They are two different things. In pantheism, what we say is, X is Y and Y is X. So God is everything and everything is God. But in panentheism, the thing is a bit different. What is said in panentheism? The whole existence, the entire existence is in God. It doesn't say the existence is God. It rather says every existence, all sorts of existence, the entire nature is in God. That's how the nature, the world is taken as a subset of God. God is a bigger set, if you imagine something like this. God is a bigger set, a universal set. Now, the world is a subset of God. Because everything is in God. That is panentheism. But in pantheism, God is everything and everything is God. So there is both the ways we are moving. X is Y and Y is X. But in other, what is happening? You say X is in Y. When you say X is in Y, that means X is a subset of Y. That is, X can be incorporated within Y. So this is panentheism. So in panentheism, let me tell you in the line that the entire world is seen as a part and parcel of God. That is, the entire creation, the entire world is seen distinct and separate from God. The entire world is taken to be say different from God, also not exactly different. We say entire creation is a subset of God, or the entire creation is in God. So this is the difference between pantheism and panentheism.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you for your brilliant explanation of all those questions. So now it's up to Kailash sir. Hello.
Okay, thanks so much Professor K. Umnan Rao for your gravity and intelligence of the subject matter in clarifying all the concepts raised by our distinguished participants. Thanks so much Mr. Devasis for your clear and sweet words while moderating the interactive session. I extend my love and best wishes on behalf of philosophy family. Okay, now we have to close the meeting.
I thank here especially Professor Pramod Kumar Das.
Yes, sir.
And Professor Kailash Das sir and Devasis Sadangi and even some others who are actively involved in carrying out this program. And above all, I give a special thanks to Professor Pramod Kumar Das for being an inseparable part of this event. Without him, we cannot think of this event. So this is how we have to give a special thanks to Professor Pramod Kumar Das. So I thank once again everybody. Thank you.
Okay, thanks.